Hi. So I got interested over the last 15 years in building strategies to detect the smallest pieces of matter that you can imagine. These pieces of matter are made of atoms, and atoms make molecules, or what we call nanoparticles, which are a few assemblies of atoms. And I'd like to study them to be able to detect them with light, using lasers, as you can see on this image, and using microscopes. Actually, there are many different ways to detect the matter at the very small scale, even down to the atomic scales. Atomic force microscopy, electron microscopy. But I prefer to use light because light is a way to study the matter inside the living matter that other methods cannot do. Actually, light is the messenger we use as human beings to build our own representation of our world. You see me, I see you, using light. And the mental representation that we make of our world is fully mediated by the light. And what I would like to tell you today is how we can transpose such representation, how we can have a mental representation of our world down to the world of the molecules, the very small world. So maybe I should mention right away the dimensions that I'm talking about to see the difficulties we might have to face towards this goal. So it's simple. From our size down to the size of the molecules, you have to zoom in 1 billion times, which is a lot. And actually, if you want to scale that to the level of the Earth, it's like looking at an ant from the space. So the men have, for a long time, built microscopes. And in your classrooms, everybody has looked once in a microscope. And maybe you never noticed because the name of microscope is so well known, and you never thought about the fact that in microscope, there is micron. And the fact that there is micron comes from a fundamental limit in physics, in optics. And this comes again from the light. This comes from the fact that you're taking images with light, and that the smallest dimension that you can separate using light is related to a fraction of the wavelengths of this light. And this fraction of the wavelengths is a fraction of a micrometer, and that's why with microscope you are stuck with images with resolutions of microns. But this doesn't tell you that you cannot have some detection of smaller objects. And actually, what happens is that if you look at objects which are much smaller than these microns, and if you have the ability to detect them, what you will see is images of this. So here, this is an example of elements, nanometer elements that are spread in space. All the images of these objects will look the same. It doesn't matter of their sizes, 1 nanometer, 10 nanometer, 50 nanometers, whatever. Everything which is below a fraction of a micron will look the same. This will look like, you see on this image, a spot, a signal which is spread on a fraction of a micron. So now imagine that you want to make an image of a variety of these objects which constitutes a scene. If they're too close to each other, you will not see them because all the signal will overlap on top of each other and you don't distinguish anything. So one of the tricks we're using in our labs is to say, hey, if we can have the ability to detect one object at a time, or one object separated from each other, far away from each other, then we might get some very useful information. And actually, it's easy, because if you have an image like you see behind me, what you can do is to say, hey, there must be an object behind it. and the position of this object, you can find its position with very great precision. And now, if these objects are in movement, if they move, even if they move by a few nanometers, you might be able to see these movements, and that's what we'll do in our experiments. So let's take an example that is quite easy to understand. We all know, for instance, that liquid move. Molecules move in liquid, you know that. You have always, if you put some ink in a glass of water, you see that there is a movement of molecules. So this is here an example of, it's not water, it's a tonic. And in a tonic, there is not only water, but there are also some other molecules. And you might know that there is a molecule which is called quinine. And if you go to nightclubs, you have certainly noticed that this kind of tonics emit light. When you put them in UV light, there is fluorescence, and this fluorescence from the quinine. This quinine inside this glass of water must move, but you don't see it because they all overlap. You don't see the movement of these molecules. Now imagine that you are able to zoom in such that you can see individual molecules of quinine. And this is what you will see. You will see this movement. And you can even track the movement of these molecules. And for that, you see that I don't have to zoom in 1 billion times anymore. Only 10,000 times with a microscope is enough. But I have information on what's going on at the nano world. OK, I was not honest here, because it's not quinine, what you see here. What I did to represent this idea is simply to put some nanoparticles in water. And as a matter of fact, this is the kind of strategy we use almost all the time. Because now what I want to show you is, because water, liquid, is quite simple, now we want to gain information of the living matter. Living matter is animals, organs, cells, organelles inside the cells, molecules inside the cells. So you see, you have a whole range of structuration in the living matter, meaning that if you want to look inside this matter, if you want to understand what the molecules inside this matter are doing, you will have to play tricks, and the tricks that we'll use is to add some objects that have good optical properties and that we will be able to detect at the individual nano-object, individual molecule level. And for that, we'll need some very good objects, objects that have some good optical properties depending on the missions we want to assign to them, depending on the structuration, on the environment they will be put in. So somehow, you know, it's like having spies that you want to send in the world, and that will send you a message. The message will be by the light. But you want that these spies are well trained such that they can fulfill the mission you design them for. So there will be two strategies here. The one strategy to say, OK, I send a spy. The spy will be alone, and it will go inside the matter, the living matter, and send us some information. That was, for example, the example of the glass of water. Now, sometimes what you want to do is to add, to label one of the biomolecules you want to study with one of these probes. We call them probes as well, such that the biomolecule with its probe, with its gadget, will be the new spy. And you want that these spies have the minimal inference with the object you want to look at, with the structuration you want to look at. So that's why we have different objects. We train them. We have fluorescent molecules, very small. We can have even proteins that the living matter can produce that we can use as spies. We can have nanocrystals made of semiconductors. We can have gold nanoparticles, so a whole variety of guys that we study. We study their optical properties at the fundamental, very fundamental level. I will not go through into that. Maybe I would like to highlight one of our last champion, I would say, which are carbon nanotubes. We got very interested in carbon nanotubes very recently. These objects, indeed, you can see right away on these pictures that have shapes which are totally different. So we train them for different missions and the other one that are circular, spherical. So these are objects which are very small in diameter, only 1 nanometer, a few atoms, but can be extremely long. Relative to their diameter, they can be a few microns, tens of microns even. So to give you a dimension, it's as if you have a fishing rod in your hand, which is 500 meters long. It's not common. So now these objects have very interesting optical properties, such that we can detect them at the level of the individual nano object. And here, this is such a carbon nanotube that you put in liquid, and you see that this object is moving, like molecules, but it's also bending. This bending oscillation actually tells you that these objects are quite rigid, actually. At the scale of the object, you might imagine that it would totally bend to make loops, and it's not the case. It's very rigid. And this rigidity actually doesn't have any equivalent in the macroscale. So they are very rigid objects. And that's very interesting, because we have discovered that if you put now this object not only in water, but you put it in an environment which is highly structured, like a small sponge. We use agarose gels, but let's see that as a sponge full of water, but with pores. But what we've seen is that this object, in this case, have the ability to move extremely efficiently. And even, they can travel through these pores more efficiently than if they had no flexibility. Their flexibility enhances their movement along their direction. So it's like snakes. And that's why people call that reptation, like reptiles. Okay? And we think that these objects are very interesting because then they can provide us some means to study the structuration of the matter. And we have plans to put them in brains, in tissues, such that we can understand what is the structuration of these tissues at the level of the nanometers. So now let's come back to what we learn when we have put all types, these different types of nano-objects that I told you about, molecules, quantum dots, fluorescent proteins, etc., when we have put them in the living matter. And what we have discovered over the last years is that the living matter is highly dynamic. There is no rest. Things are always moving. And actually, the energy that drives all this movement at this level, at these scales, is driven by the thermal energy. So you have this thermal energy which makes things in movement. And then the living matter only has to adjust these movements of the molecules which move. And it's clear that this allows the living matter to be extremely plastic, extremely robust, to adapt to any type of solicitation of aggressions of pathogens to adapt without to create a whole machinery which would need a lot of energy to adapt. And I think this new representation of the matter as something being totally in movement is very different from what we experience in daily life. At our scale, things are almost all the time immobile. In this room, I'm almost the only one to move. Okay? You're steady. The human mind has the habit to put things in certain places with not much movement. The living matter is totally different. And I think it's very difficult to imagine that you have no rest. There is no sleep in that. Things move all the time, all the time. And you have exchange of movement between the particles. And the molecules can experience all type of movement and have the probability to experience all types of movements. So now, sometimes, as a researcher, I'm wondering, can we, at our scale, at the scale of the human being, can we have a true representation of what that means to be in a world that where everything moves all the time, that is always in movement? I'm not sure we can. We can always use equations that we can do, and we do that. But to really have a feeling, a representation, the same representation you have of your surrounding, the same representation I have from what I see, can we really make pictures like this of a world in movement all the time? And I think this difficulty comes from the fact that we are not at the scale ourselves. We are not at the scales of the things we are looking at. The only thing we have is some small signals coming from spies we have put in our environment. And don't you think that it's also a bit the same situation if you want to look at the very large scales, the universe? It's not our scale at all. We try to get signals coming from objects from which we have a representation of small spots, a little bit like what I'm doing for the very small. And we are trying to build a representation of something we are not living in. Light is really amazing, isn't it? Thank you.